Good afternoon, family. I love y'all. I almost sent this yesterday, but I'm glad I waited. I have more wisdom on the issue now. The wisdom of God keeps getting deeper and deeper as you dive in. I'm calling this message, "The Devil Made Me Do It." When I was growing up, a couple of years younger, when I was about 9 or 10, we used to watch a comedian named Flip Wilson. And whenever Flip Wilson would get in a skit and he would do something wrong, and if a police officer said, "Why did you do that? Why did you hit so-and-so?" Or, you know, something like that, Flip would respond with, "The devil made me do it." And so I think we can all identify. We've had times where it's easy to just blame it on the devil. However, God, through the Apostle Paul in Romans 7 and 8, explains to us the real answer for what we're doing. So I'm going to read from Romans chapter 7, verses 15 through 25, and I'm reading in the Passion Translation. And so I really love this Passion Translation. And let's start. "I'm a mystery to myself, for I want to do what is right, but end up doing what my moral instincts condemn. And if my behavior is not in line with my desire, my conscience still confirms the excellence of the law. And now I realize it is no longer my true self doing it, but the unwelcome intruder of sin in my humanity. For I know that nothing good lives within my flesh of my fallen humanity. The longings to do what is right are within me, but willpower is not enough to accomplish it. My lofty desires to do what is good are dashed when I do the things I want to avoid. So if my behavior contradicts my desires to do good, I must conclude that it is not my true identity doing it, but the unwelcome intruder of sin hindering me from being who I really am. Through my experience of this principle, I discover that even when I want to do good, evil is ready to sabotage me. Truly, deep within my identity, I love to do what pleases God. But I discern another power operating in my humanity, waging a war against the moral principles of my conscience and bringing me into captivity as a prisoner to the law of sin, this unwelcome intruder in my humanity. What an agonizing situation I'm in. So who has the power to rescue this miserable man from the unwelcome intruder of sin and death? I give all my thanks to God, for His mighty power has finally provided a way out through our Lord Jesus, the Anointed One. So if left to myself, the flesh is aligned with the law of sin. But now my renewed mind is fixed on and submitted to God's righteous principles." I remember, so many times, and even now, so many times you do things and you go, "Why did I do that? I know better. I don't want to do that." And so this Romans chapter 7 was a good thing. I would read that and go, "Man, I know what Paul's talking about. I don't want to do something bad, but I keep doing it. And I want to do something good and I don't do it. What's going on here?" And so in Romans chapter 8, you go right after that and you go to Romans chapter 8. And in the Passion Translation, it says, "So now the case is closed. There remains no accusing voice of condemnation against those who are joined in life union with Jesus, the Anointed One. For the law of the Spirit of life, flowing through the anointing of Jesus, has liberated us from the law of sin and death." So we have been set free from the law of sin and death. We actually have been set free from sin. We no longer have to sin. Before we got saved, we had to sin. We had no choice. Sin owned us. But now sin no longer owns us. Now, I want to go over to Galatians chapter 5. And again, I'm still in the Passion Translation, and I just want to read this. I'm going to go down to verse 19, and this is going to talk about some of the things that maybe we struggle with. I don't want to point out anybody's particular This is what I do. This is what I struggle with. I'm just going to read through a list that the Apostle Paul wrote. The cravings of the self life are obvious: sexual immorality, lustful thoughts, pornography, chasing after things instead of God, manipulating others, hatred of those who get in your way, senseless arguments, resentment when others are favored, temper tantrums, angry quarrels, only thinking of yourself, being in love with your own opinions, being envious of the blessings of others, murder, uncontrolled addictions, wild parties, and all other similar behavior. Haven't I already warned you that those who use their freedom for these things will not inherit the kingdom realm of God? And so find your thing in there that you know you need to deal with and that you want victory over. It's in there. If it's not, it's there. So you need to be set free from it. But now here's the part. Here's the thing. In verses 22 and 23, he says, "But the fruit produced by the Holy Spirit within you is divine love in all its varied expressions." As I read this in the Passion Translation, it totally changed everything I thought about Galatians chapter 5, 22 and 23. Everything that I thought about regarding the fruit of the Spirit. I'm sure a lot of you grew up with the flannel graphs where you had the different fruits. You had the apples, the oranges, the grapes, the pineapples, the bananas, you know, representing a different fruit of peace, love, joy, kindness, gentleness. So we're all familiar with that. But actually, the fruit that is produced by the Holy Spirit within us is love, divine love. And then it's expressed in varied ways like joy that overflows, peace that subdues, patience that endures, kindness in action, a life full of virtue, faith that prevails, gentleness of heart, and strength of spirit. Never set the law above these qualities, for they are meant to be limitless. And now, here's an encouragement for you. Keep in mind that we who belong to Jesus, the Anointed One, have already experienced crucifixion. For everything connected with our self-life was put to death on the cross and crucified with Messiah. Hallelujah. We must live in the Holy Spirit and follow after Him. That's the key, family. We must live in the Holy Spirit and follow after Him. That's the key. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Do what He says. Desire to do the right things. And so here's the point. If we try to not do bad things, we're going to do bad things. If we desire to do good things, we're going to do good things. If we do a bad thing, I remember playing sports. You make a mistake, you miss a ball, you swing and miss, you strike out. And whenever you would come back to the good coach would say, shake it off, right? Shake it off. I don't want you to think about the mistake that you made, because if you keep thinking about the mistake you made, you're going to commit the mistake again. But if you shake it off and you think about what do you do right, right? Get down lower. Keep your eye on the ball. Keep your shoulder up, right? If you miss a shot, what do you do in basketball? Get your feet set. Get your arms, right? You start to think about the right things you need to do versus I made a mistake. Because if you rehearse that mistake over and over, you're gonna commit it again. You're going to be prone to commit it again. God doesn't want you to keep thinking about the sin you committed. Think about the righteousness that He has prepared for you, and you live that way. All right, I love you, family. I hope you have a great weekend.